Buenos dias. It is a Sunday morning.
Coming out of my cage and I've been doing just fine. Daughter gotta be down because I want it all. Daughter now with a kiss. How did it end up like this? It was only a kiss. It was only a kiss. Now I'm falling asleep and she's calling a cab while she's having a smoke and she's having a drink. Now they're going to bed and my stomach is sick and it's all in my head, but she's touching his chest now. He takes off her dress now. Let me go. Oh. I just can't look, it's killing me and taking control.
Why can't I just turn up?
Okay, here we go.
Jealousy, burning seats into the sea, swimming through sick lullabies, joking on your alibis. But it's just the price I pray. Destiny is calling me. Open up my eager hide, 'cause I'm Mr. Brightside. I've been doing just fine. Gotta be them because I want it all. Starting out with a kiss. How did it end up like this? It was only a kiss. It was only a kiss. Now I'm falling asleep and she's calling a cab and she's having a smoke while she's taking a drag. Now it's having and then my stomach gets sick and it's all in my head. God, she's touching his chest now. He takes off her dress now. Let me go. I just can't look, it's killing me and taking control. Jealousy, turning Satan to the sea, dreaming through sick lullabies, joking on your alibis. But it's just the price I pay. Destiny is calling me. Open up my eager eyes. I'm Mr. Brightside.
Yes. Put this down real quick. Yes.
Your ears do not deceive you. We are playing with the bass today.
Yo.
Yeah, just switching it up, you know, the whole point of this thing, thank you, Sinking, is to have a kind of understanding of the whole band. You know, I've been playing instruments since the third grade, quote unquote. Professionally, academically, let's just say academically. Just the idea of like being hands-on with all the parts of a project is kind of what gets me like in the zone of like, yeah, okay, this is what we need, this is what we got. So me being able to like expand and try stuff in the background with like all my other instruments, even looking at a drum set that I still haven't touched to this day. But stuff like that really kind of seems fun, and that's what I am. Not even seems, it is one of those passionate calls that I have not been able to heed the call because of, you know, just life builds and whatnot. However, you know, with this, it'd be fun. It's a nice sunny relaxing morning. I like dedicating these Sundays to just A, doing the news, getting that information through, because that's that musical information solving person like stuff. And then B, getting that creative left brain structure developed by playing these songs. And in case you mates haven't noticed, I suck because all these songs are like just playthroughs. I don't really practice, like I just kind of go for it when we do these things. So it's always nerve-wracking to be like, yo man, you're gonna fuck up at this point. Or like even now playing the bass, like since the frets are so far apart compared to a guitar, like my mental memory of like how far I have to shift up and down the neck to get to a certain note is skewed by how wide the frets are. So that's why me going between the chords, I would be messing up a couple of times because I'm like, damn, that's all the way down here. I have to focus on the fret, knowing where my finger is gonna go, and then I have to focus on the notes on the computer as I'm trying to keep up with the pace and singing all the lyrics with all that. And that's fun, that's exciting. I think I enjoy making mistakes because you learn from them. So that's always something to take into account, and you know, I'll keep this in account, and hopefully we do something fun with that. I think it's the beginning of something beautiful. But hey, speaking of beautiful Sundays, let's go ahead and jump into the news, ladies and gentlemen. It's been an interesting week today. I'm gonna leave the syncing, thank you, provided by syncing. This is why those are dangerous. This is why I don't like having background music, because I get distracted. But I think for the sake of fluidity, I think it'd be cool to have some BGM in the background. So we'll try that. Thank you, Syncing. You're the best. You're the go-to. Just have a little fun with that. Like I love you. Speaking of news, vámonos. Bienvenidos.
Muchachos. Onas.
Yes, sir. Starting off with a hot, fiery topic. Nah. We'll see. It all works together. Sorry. It all works together, so it kind of...
We'll get there together.
Yosh. Number one. Hello. It's Sunday. It's a very... warm Sunday in sunny California, so I'll do my best not to overheat as we're doing all these hot topics.
Yeah.
Hey, Apple, number one on the list. This is by Kotaku. John Walker over at Kotaku. Apple could be fined $50 million a day. All right, but we've been updated. So here we go. EU, back in March, the European Union brought in new rules. They were designed to stop companies like Apple and Google from blocking third-party companies running their own in-app item stores. This was supposed to be carved a path for games like Fortnite to be able to return to mobile. Now they could ruin in-game purchases without having to use Apple or Google's own stores, thus regain 30% of every purchase. But it may be the case that EU, Europe, thinks Apple still isn't playing fair and start imposing enormous fines. Let's see what they have to say. Hey-yo. The theory was the EU's Digital Market Act would allow apps and games to run on their own independent payment systems, which came to in-app purchases. Anything previously launched on iOS required that all payments go through Apple's own systems, and there the company would take a 30% cut every time. Mm-hmm. Companies like Epic very loudly agreed that the system was deeply unfair. And while it was hard to pick a side between the greedy corps taking money off the apps and the apps taking money off their customers, Epic was right in that anti-competitive. That it was anti-competitive. The EU agreed, announcing the DMA in 2023 and bringing it into law this year. So stuff like that, right? Thanks to EU rules, new Fortnite is coming back to iPhones update. Wow. However, cheeky Apple immediately constructed its own loopholes by allowing apps to run in their own stores, but only if they paid a so-called core technology fee. Oh my God. Of 50 cents per install of their app. Okay. The charge only applied to companies with over a million installs in the previous 12 months. Wow. But it was obviously aimed at ensuring the company would still get its tithe on its face. It's very obviously not in the spirit of the new rules. Right, okay. It's also worth noting that surprise breakout success apps could be especially badly stung by this. Suddenly discovering charges of 1 cent or £1 every two installs of their viral product, plus an additional 3% fees using iOS. Wow, 3% fees for using iOS payment processing software, and very quickly get in a whole heap of trouble. Yeah, because it's like random costs or charges, huh? Tim Sweetie was predictably unimpressed in January 2024, as he described it as a devious new instance of malicious compliance. Damn, this is really hard to do. Base. I don't know why the base is like, I don't know, longer, wider. Hi. James Sweeney was quote, Apple's plan to thwart Europe's new digital market acts is a devious new instance of malicious compliance. They are forcing developers to choose between App Store's exclusivity and the store terms, which will be illegal under DMA, or accept a new, also illegal, anti-competitive. Tim Sweeney. Huh. Seems that the EU somewhat agrees to, according to the report in Financial Times, paper sources say the European Commission believes Apple is not complying with law and such as will speak soon begin to imposing fines, the first brought under DMA. Fines, how much are these fines? Those fines are cheap. It's officially announced that Apple's in violation of the DMA, the maximum charge is 5% of average daily turnover, which in Apple's case is terrifying 5% is one, wow. Oh, it's a terrifying 1 billion, meaning 50 million a pop. Meanwhile, the same EU group is investigating whether Meta, Facebook, and Alphabet, Google might be falling foul of the rules. The FT also notes that Apple could still have time to change the new system to avoid the fines. Apple told FT that the company is confident our plan complies with the DMA and that they will continue to constructively engage with the European Commission as they conduct their investigations. Correction, 11 a.m. and 20th. This article and headline previously incorrectly stated the fine would be $1 billion a day. Due to ambiguous wording on reporting, we since spotted an error and fixed it. Yeah, okay. Wow. So here's the thing. We're trying to get these guys to not have to pay for using their online services, their online stores. That includes Apple, that includes Google, that includes PSN to a certain extent. We've seen PlayStation start to charge their third-party people a certain amount of fees, and that's not really cool because it starts kind of creating this divide, right? It's like a barrier gap or like a culture gap or a financial gap, whatever you want to call it. But it's concerning in the way that the money that is being transferred around is being so scrutinized, and like, seeing how freaking 5% of billion is 50 million, right? We had that math up here. And that's freaking insane, dog. Like, oh, you're literally out of here. It's like, bro, what are we doing with this cash flow? Like, real talk. Like, it's out there. It's fucking being thrown around like it's like chopped liver, but like it's out there. So why aren't we focused on the things that need the work instead of like, quote unquote, I don't want to cuss off so early in the day. It's a Sunday, damn it. Instead of complaining about, hey man, you're on my market spot, so you got to give me a rent payment. Basically, we're charging rent, digital rent on people who are trying to sell their product at a digital storefront. They're just reserving a little booth kiosk, a mall kiosk to sell their games, and they're being charged for rent, which is, it makes sense in the business perspective, but I think it's fucking disgusting that makes sense. Why is that the business perspective, you know? Like, it's, maybe knock down the prices and figure it out. I get the idea of like having the platform. It's great. Everybody loves PlayStation, or quote, everyone loved PlayStation. Right now we're seeing a flow to Microsoft, and I do believe that's because we're seeing all these like money hungry power moves from all these corporations who are trying to expand and make all these big ass like entertainment business ventures. But at the same time, you're kind of giving off this shitty vibe, and everybody who's purchasing your product looks at it and goes like, well, dude, you could not be an asshole about this. So what's gonna happen? What's gonna change? And like the fact that Apple just goes like, all right, we'll charge you for this or whatever. I guess it is like them lowering their prices, and that's the step in the right direction. But I don't know. We'll have to see. Honestly, though, I think as shitty as it is, because it is a business, I think Apple might have the right of way in terms of like, oh, all right, well, we're just gonna charge for this much and it'll be a flat payment and all that BS. But I don't know, man. It just rubs me the wrong way. Like, let me put it this way. When I had that big ass job that I thought was gonna be like fucking godsend and like all this bullshit, and then to like be taxed up the ass for overworking myself that whole year, it really diminished the idea of like, well, what the fuck am I working for? If these are the parameters, something is not right. Something here is not working, and I need to work around those parameters, or I need to fix it, or blah 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 blah. That's kind of what I feel is happening in terms of like, these people are creating things to create something awesome, and they're here and they're putting in their time, their effort, their money, their values into this product. And if, you know, they maybe spend 10 years, 5 years of their lives developing something that they know they want to put their whole effort behind, and they make Among Us, you know, and that shit fucking blows up and everyone starts downloading it, and suddenly you get this company that's like, yo, we can probably save and invest and do more, or like focus on jobs or expanding or X amount of things. But then you get a fucking bill, your rent due bill from Apple and Sony and X amount of companies. And you're like, well, what the fuck, man? How are we supposed to make money if all these fucking companies, power hungry, money wealthy companies are fucking absorbing the little extra spending cash that we're making? And I don't claim to know like how much each developer is creating and all that, but like, dude, come on, dudes, come on. Moving on. Wait. Yeah, baby.
Drop my pick.
Finger. Bring your friends. Ish. So remember how we talked about AI last week? Hi, friend. I love you. Little one. best friend A with the A. Okay. Here we go. Still hanging out with John Walker over at Kotaku. McDonald's drive-thru AI is canceled. Because Japan. All right. AI is a big business. It's such a big business right now. It's propelled NVIDIA, the company that you once knew for making GeForce graphics, to become the biggest business in the world. Shit. And yet technology is so far next to useless in all but the most specific circumstances. For example, McDonald's has just announced that it's banning this disastrous experiment with AI after it turned out people didn't want bacon on their ice cream. No way. Yay. Oh, I feel. Yay! Oh, it's Spyro!
The technology introduced to around 100 McDonald's, to watch Spyro, to McDonald's stores in 2022 was supposed to be the future of its drive-thrus, where a magical robot would listen to the orders and we'll get back to you on that one. Process them rather than some low-tech meat sack human being. It has, of course, proven far worse, with orders going completely barmy. Now, according to the report by Restaurant Business, the fast food giant is ending an experiment. It's ending the experiment for now. The AI was developed for Ronald and his chums by IBM. But that partnership is now coming to an end, with the AI drive-thrus being removed from over the next month. For an example of how successful they were, just look at the TikTok. Typical redhead. That TikTok was to appreciate this. No, I'm good.
Oh, no.
Monkeys, spinny monkeys. That guy. Trying to use a drill. And then, again. And my favorite, this guy trying to convince McBot not to add bacon to his ice cream. It's okay. It's okay, it's an oversimplistic. Oh, shit. Draw my pick. To refer to AI as something specific rather than multifarious technologies that all rely on some form of machine learning. There are the god-awful generative AIs that we hear most about. Industrial scale plagiarism machines like ChatGPT, Midjourney. There are also the models being used to massively accelerate drug discovery and cancer treatments. Wow. But it's fair to say that in the immediate, the vast majority of times we hear about a company embracing AI, it literally translates to seeing how many people's jobs we can fuck over for profit. And of course, this is the most likely intention McDonald's could have had here, given they already had a mostly functioning drive-thru system where humans took the orders. Sadly, this isn't the end of McD's experiments with AI. The company insists it's going to carry on exploring the tech. Plus, you know, all the other chains are trying it too. Anything to stop having to pay for those people their minimum wages. Jesus, Mary and Joseph. And I'll tell you what, as a Brit, I'm with the AI on this one. Rolling. Do we want to check that? I don't know if I want to check that, but. Nah, I'm good. Bum, 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 bum. All right, well, AI continues to make its AI movements. And again, like they say, it's not terrible. We have good things happening. We have cool projects being made. Some creative minds are really doing their best to better humanity. And then the fucking like corporate assholes are just trying to save money. You know, they see any new technology and are like, yo, so how can we sell this? AKA, how can we make money off of this? Sure, that's their prerogative and that's their intent and all that, but like, listen, dog. If your fucking plan is to eliminate the graveyard shift for humans, then you're focusing on a certain individual group of people. And those people are not going to be able to communicate fucking chicken nuggets at 3 a.m. after the bar. You do not need a fucking robot who does not understand human inebriation to be taking orders when the poor dude who's trying to take our order is having a difficult time understanding English. That's some short-sighted bullshit that's like, come on, dog. But I get it. They have the money. They have the technology. They're just gonna go fucking spend it, call it, write it off as a loss, and get a tax rebate. So fuck you guys. But hey, what about that bacon on the ice cream, though? Hey, so you what? All right, Anime News Network, my friend. Oh, you thought we were done? No. That gets better. Anime Concerts AI Flyer art leads to Evangelion singer Yoko Takahashi bowing out. Son of a potato nugget. It's real. Orchestra released flyers. Oh, this is by Rafael Antonio Pineda. Okay. Orchestra released flyers with new art with July 10 performances moving forward as planned. The Ikebukuro Anime Philharmonic, an orchestra dedicated to performing anime music. Very nice. Announced on Wednesday that that iconic anime singer Yoko Takahashi will no longer perform as a guest in the orchestra's July 10th performance due to the orchestra using generative AI for promotional art. The announcement noted that the orchestra was receiving negative comments regarding generative AI for art for its flyers and website, and that this led to Takahashi pulling out from the performance.
below is the first version of the Flyers. Flyers. That just makes me think of a, what was that one? Death Parade? Death March? Death Billards? Flying. Whoa. Go, mighty, go. Go, mighty, go. I forgot the lyrics for that, but yeah. It was by Bredo. It's a band called Bredo. They do a lot of like very funky poppy stuff. They also did the opening for the third opening for Kaguya-sama, Love is War. Good shit. Hey, AI, who's that? I can't find my cursor. No. Damn it. It's hard, man. Memory. Oh, there he is. 27-1, 27-10, 1-8, 2014. All right, we got Power, One Piece, Slam Dunk, Hunter, I can't read that, it's tiny. I can't read that. Rashiko, girl, half. Rama, one half. I know. Anyways. Buraku, Kurova. Hi, Sugiwa. King's Game. Oshinoko, Idol. All right. Yo, this is your AI art. All these guys. We just know because of this, huh? Man, you really gotta replace the orchestra beauty with drums? I guess I get it. Anime sells. Fuck, cute anime girls and shit. The orchestra's website released a new version of Flyers. Of the Flyers. Lion. Seen below on Thursday. Anime fail harmonic. We got the power. And they added another human being. There you go. Concert Master Will. You know what? I'll tell you what. That's a fucking badass title. That makes me want to change my my career choices. All right. The day has come. Yo, slam dunk. Dunk. Ranma. I was right, Ranma. Oh, yeah. As of Thursday, stores in Tokyo's Akihabara district still had the original version of the flyers on display and for free distribution. The orchestra apologized for the matter, saying that it did not sufficiently take into account the issues and criticisms surrounding the generative AI. The performer is still moving forward as planned. Yo Matsushita, a musical artist who serves as the head of the orchestra, posted again on Friday to explain further and personally apologize to other musicians. Takahashi, the sponsoring companies, and the other exclusive committee members. He acknowledged that as a musician involved in the arts, he was unaware and uninformed regarding the issues facing creators due to generative AI. Oh, I see what you... Yeah, because it's not just about the art. It's about the fucking... Well, art is art. But it's also about the sound of all things. Like, keeping the purity of, like, realistic talent. You know. Takahashi is perhaps best known for performing an opening theme song, Cruel Angel's Thesis, and one rendition of Fly Me to the Moon. Yep, any theme song for the Neon, that's by Frank Sinatra, by the way. Any theme song for Neon Genesis Evangelion television anime series, as well as Soul's Refrain, the theme song of Evangelion, Death and Rebirth. Takahashi has also performed theme songs for Cross and J, Rondo of Angel and Dragon. I think I watched that one. Hey, yo. Pumpkin Scissors, Shotgun Oshana, hey, yo. My Goddess, This Ugly, A Beautiful World, and Aquarian Age, the movie. Right. So popular. So, shout out. Yeah, that's kind of ballsy. Like, goated for her. Because, like, again, we're talking about this whole new wave of businesses trying to do their best to, like, save on money and be cheap asses because things are fucking so marginalized in profits and fucking stupid. But we got these people out here who are like, you know what, dog? I got something to say. Fuck you. No. And literally just walks out. So that's A, that's ballsy. That's pretty G as fuck. B, I respect it in terms of like having something to say for your fellow constituents when it comes to the arts and saying, hey, man, like, yeah, it's cool and it helps us, but like, no. This is pure human spirit ringing from our souls and fucking veins and all that shit is fucking human emotion. Don't just bullshit it with it, with, you know, artificially You can't replicate beauty like that. You know what I mean? So let it be beautiful. Let it speak for itself. All right? Don't be a cheap ass. Wait, moving on. Oh, you thought we were done? Nah. This one's fun. I really, well, just don't share this with GPT.
Whew.
Let me pick up my pick.
The revelation song is where I drew some blood. I couldn't get enough.
And the art of Megan is Megan, the show, that just show. Well, there's a show about it now. Okay, the movie by Blumhouse. Man, Megan getting erotic thriller spinoff about Lovebot who turns deadly. Whew. Ladies and gentlemen, I have been waiting for this exact moment. Waiting is a strong word. I have been fearing this exact moment for years. We are at that point. Alrighty. A man buys a love bot after his wife passes away. Can you imagine what happens next? Artificial Intelligence by Eddie Makuch. Alright, over at Game Informer. Artificial Intelligence is a hot topic in 2024, and Blumhouse is tempted to cash in with not only an AI-inspired sequel to the breakout hit Megan, but now a spinoff about a romantic doll that comes to life, according to the Hollywood Reporter. Blumhouse is moving ahead with a film titled Soulmate. Oh, that's cute. That is so cute. That's described as an erotic thriller. The film sees a man acquiring an artificially intelligent android to cope with the loss of his recently deceased wife. In an attempt to create a truly sentient partner, he inadvertently turns a harmless love bot into a deadly soulmate. Reads a line from the movie's description. Blumhouse is partnering with James Wan's Atomic Monster, hell yeah. He's the guy that's directing the new Superman. Oh, I should have put in that picture of Daily Planet they showed off. Atomic Monster on the spinoff after both companies enjoyed great success with the original Megan film. Soulmate is being fast-tracked for release and already has a date on the calendar, January 2nd, 2026. Hey, yo, January babies, woo! With Universal on the board to distribute. Best babies. Universal on the board to distribute. You're Not My Mother. Oh, wait a minute. I thought I said How I Met Your Mother. Director Katie Dolan has signed on to direct Soulmate. She rewrote the script too, following an earlier draft by Salvage Marines writer Raphael Jordan. Jordan Wan and Ingrid Bisou are attributed with coming up with the story. Fundamentally, I view this film as an exploration of relationships and loneliness, Dolan said in a statement. Despite technological advances, there are enduring human truths we cannot escape, and I am looking forward to delving into those depths. As for the Megan sequel, Megan 2.0, dope. That is. I fucking love this market, or the titling on this. Releases on June 27th, 2025. As mentioned, the sequel delves further into AI, with one saying, "We're exploring the AI universe even further with the sequel." Blumhouse is also making a Five Nights at Freddy's sequel and recently announced ambitious plans in the video game space. Very good. Yes, we love that. Blumhouse doing good shit out there, but also hitting the nail on the... Wait, what? Hitting the nail on the head, damn it. Whew. AI. Oh, sorry. Again, it's cool. Don't get me wrong. It is very cool. I like the idea of growth and development and how we can improve ourselves for the betterment of the universe, Ayona. But, and, no buts. Okay, maybe a little bit. And they're also hitting on the human element, right? So Blumhouse has always been a strong horror presence. Not necessarily because it's like scary ass film. Some of them do hit that line, but they're usually very well thought out and developed stories, and just the scenarios that come around in these are very intriguing. And they're not necessarily, sometimes they're not necessarily like like horror shit. It's more of a thrilling, like there's something that's gonna happen, but we're not sure what that issue is. And seeing, which is a perfect analogy for how we as humanity should feel about this technology, growing technology. We don't understand anything. We can never understand something that is not like, it's like not able to open up on a deep level with us. And that takes a soul. That takes recognizing one person's soul and connecting on the level. So yeah, maybe we can get there. You never know. But like, the fact that they're going for the craziest scenario, let's say, where we hit a point in the universe where people don't want to get married, people don't want to have kids, people don't want to even fucking date because they already know everyone's being an asshole out there, and like they're going to be talking to 20 other people just to fucking ghost somebody on whatever. That is the environment that we have built, and now they're coming in here and being like, hey, you know the future? Here's something to think about, which reminds me of James Cameron and Loki, what he did with the robot Terminator. So it's ticking horror, but ticking horror because it's realistic as fuck. And that right there is the true testament of horror. To know that at any point, we could fucking slip down the rabbit hole and we'd end up in this point. And what will those consequences be? Whew. Well, only time will tell. remember to thank your artificial secretaries? What is it? Supporters? Whatever you call them. helpers. Yes, they're cool. Thank you, friend. Love you. Okay. All right, moving on. But yes. Okay. Speaking of something movie related, that's not looking good. I'll get back to what I see the link in this, but we'll finish this article and then we'll go back to talking about something that relates to Megan. So we'll be there. It all makes sense. We'll get there. New details emerge about Blade's Rocky development at Marvel Studios. Now we know why a parade of writers and directors haven't been able to get Marvel's Blade out of development yet. By Blair Marinell over at GameStop. Not every Marvel movie has a smooth plan to the big screen. Edgar Wright spent the better part of a decade developing Ant-Man, and he didn't get, which would have been a fucking cool-ass movie because of how expressive Edgar Wright is with his effects. Scott Pilgrim versus the World. That's it. That's all you need to think about. But he didn't even get to direct the film because he left over creative differences with Marvel Studios. But so far, one of Marvel's most troubled films in development has been Blade, which recently lost its senior second director, Jan Demange. Now, a new report has shed some light on Blade's rocky development, including details about the previous drafts of the film. Marshall Ali and Kevin Feige jointly announced the Blade reboot at San Diego Comic-Con in 2019, 5 years ago. And according to The Hollywood Reporter, Ali has an inordinate amount of influence on this film behind the scenes. The report indicates that Ali took it upon himself to recruit Damange as the director because he was unsatisfied with the Marvel's potential replacements for Bassam Thraik, the first director to exit Blade in 2022. Numerous scribes have turned in scripts. That's cute. Numerous scribes. For Blade, some which were set in different time periods. The version of Blade that was almost filmed in 2023 would have been set in 1920s. Ooh. Mia Goth was classed as Lilith. Mia Goth. Oh, the girl from the horror movies. She's going to be in Maxine, this is the newest one, which was a great fucking way to roll out that series, by the way. Double X, XX. Yeah. Yeah. X Factor. On this behind the scenes, the report indicates that Ali took it upon himself. Mia Goth was cast as Lilith, an ancient vampire who wanted the blood of Blade's daughter for some nefarious purpose. That take on the films has been abandoned, Blade has a daughter, in favor of a new script sent in the present. However, Goth remains the only cast member besides Ali, who's still attached to the film. Other cast members, including Delroy Lindo and Aaron Pierre, have been released. It isn't clear if Blade's daughter is still part of the movie. There has reportedly been tension between Ali and Marvel over the slow pace of Blade's development, but neither side is abandoning the movie. Fantastic Four and Turnable screenwriter Eric Pearson is the latest writer to take on a draft of Blade. Once Pearson finishes his script, the search for a new director may begin as soon as the end of this summer. For now, Blade is still slated to be released on November 7th, 2025. However, it's very unlikely to keep the date, and it will probably be rescheduled.
Damn!
That's terrible. yeah, that's terrible, man. Okay.
Why is this having problems? I have no idea. Is it like a direction in like vision, like what we should represent the character being? What's this deal with the... Oh, Blade's daughter. And then they want her to be a fucking like next Avenger and all this bullshit. They're still laying down the groundwork to have all the freaking the Marvel kids become like the next Avengers in the future. But like, low key, we're kind of past that, man. Like, don't get me wrong, I love superheroes as much as the other guy, and like I still keep an eye on the comics and what happens in between the big turning points and the event points and all that. But like, and I'll still watch a movie here and there. I don't mind watching Blade movies, Marvel movies. That's probably in my future, very soon, very easily in my future. But I think it's obvious for us to understand that as a society, a pop culture society, we're kind of over the movie, the superhero hypeness. And not to say that there can't be a cool superhero movie, but like, we don't really need to expect much. We don't really expect much from these things anymore. There used to be a time before Endgame and before Infinity War where like we were fervently waiting for the next chapter because it was like we were reading a book, like a movie book, and each new film was adding to this grand scale like universe, right? And we did that. It took us 10, 15 years, but we fucking did it. and like when you finish a game, you kind of have this sense of like accomplishment. Like, okay, I did this, or at least speaking for myself, right? Like I did this, I completed it. I don't want to touch this for the next week or month because I need that sense of finale. Like we did this shit, we did the job, we had fun, and this is where we ended. I had a great time. This is me closing the book. So it's hard for us to kind of go from that mental state to be like, oh yeah, we could totally get hyped for this next generation of heroes when like, kind of been there, done that, you know? And I don't necessarily need them to stop.
Is that relaxing music?
Don't need them to stop making superhero movies. I just feel like they need to really reanalyze what they should be spending their development money, for lack of a better term, their movie budget money on, like what type of films we need to be seeing. And I would love a vampire Blade movie. I've never seen the original Blade trilogy, like by New Line Cinema, and that's something that I should probably do. So I will look into that. But I feel like these comic book heroes are not being respected per se. So whether that comes from the actors wanting to really like influence the character and wanting to be like, no, I gotta be the next Robert Downey Jr., like Iron Man has to be me, dog. Maybe that's kind of where things are feeling weird, but I mean, or maybe it's just like that loss of creative development. But all that really matters is that we make sure that we care about the things that we're making and we're actually focusing on what our vision is, so we're not just throwing away money and having to fire people when we're out of money. That's kind of where I'm at with that. So yeah, Godspeed to everybody working on Blade. I hope it works out. Hope things work out, and it's going to be hard. It's going to be an uphill battle for them to kind of remake all this money that they're using, that they're spending, that they're throwing away, because, you know, whether the vision be muddied or whether they don't have a plan, now that that one Marvel villain, what's his face, the Conqueror guy, got X-listed or blacklisted, or was it, yeah, listed on Hollywood, so now he's out of the game. But hey, man. My last point on this thing was going to be that I get the feeling that we're past the superhero age in movies in Hollywood. And yes, we're now heading into the AI era, which is, again, Megan, all these, like, whether it be a horror thing or like the new quote unquote Avengers, what was it? Avengers event or Avengers level threat. Is gonna be these Terminators showing up. So I feel like that's the direction that we're gonna go into. We're gonna see more of this technology in films and how that affects us, maybe. Maybe. I think that's how they're gonna try to fucking rationalize all this adoption rate of yeah, intelligence and all that. But hey, that's enough for the movies. Hope it works out. Blade sounds like a cool-ass character, so I need to watch the movies, and I need to know if he's like, if it was a Wesley Snipes thing or if it was a Blade thing. But speaking of movies, All right. You in charge of the movie in the works, as everyone wonders, where the hell the next game is? This is my Moises Taveras over by Kotaku. This is not the Uncharted sequel most folks have been waiting for. ¿Por qué? ¿Qué pasó? Sequel to 2022 Uncharted film is probably five of us. Actually likes its official in production. The news was confirmed by Variety earlier today after Sony mentioned the Uncharted sequel at Cine Europe 2024 while running down its pipeline of upcoming movies. Hello. The Uncharted film, which was set to be released in the height of the pandemic before numerous days, was finally released in 2022. Though it debuted to mixed reviews, the movie was a box office success, warranting an obvious sequel. Very nice. Though we know very little about Uncharted sequel at the moment, it's likely safe to assume that the movie leads Tom Holland and Mark Wahlberg will be reprising their roles as the rogue duo of Nathan Drake and Victor Sully Sullivan, respectively. The first movie acted as a sort of origin story for how the now iconic treasure hunters first met, and much of the games have charted the development of the relationship, making their dynamic easy fodder to continue mining for further movies. All right. Ending also ultimately sets the beginning of the first game in charge of Drake's fortune, which follows Nate Sully as they track down the treasure of Nate's namesake, Sir Francis Drake, and come across some Nazi fuckery during their adventure. Though the next one could be an original story, much like the first, following the games for here on out seems like a pretty natural progression. If Uncharted sequel's film does follow the games and adapts the first one, it will also likely include one of the last major characters in the main cast, Elena Fisher. Elena is a reporter who follows and finances Nate and Sully's journey in the first game. But over the course of the series, becomes Nate's foil and eventually even his wife. Their dynamic, as well as Elena's unique ability to cut through Nate's BS, gives us some of the best parts of their games. Their banter and sweeping romance is right for the big screen. And if I'm being honest, this first film felt like it was really lacking Elena.
Whoa.
All right. So after confirmation that another Uncharted film was in the works, the series has been pretty quiet for now. After retiring Nate in 2016's Thief's End, there had only been one other title in the franchise, which the subsequent year, Lost Legacy, that spinoff began as an expansion to A Thief's End, followed Chloe Fraser, the main character of the series, who did have a feature in the first film. Considering it's now been 7 years since the game came out, some feel like it's time for 7 years for a new Uncharted game rather than another film. Okay, well, I guess that makes sense, but I mean, last one. Naughty Dog, the studio that created Uncharted, has been busy since moving on to this. Yeah, but we're doing movies, or we're doing Last of Us stuff, I guess. On a series, though, predominantly which is other mega-ton multimedia franchise, The Last of Us, while there's little hope the studio picking back up the reins, Sony has plenty on other studios that can take up the mantle, or enough resources to form a team to do it. Maybe one day we'll get the Uncharted sequel that folks actually want. Don't say.
Say it ain't so.
Yes. Uncharted movies. again, we are still, I guess we'll call this the technological era. Because it's like Hollywood adapting to all the smart technological stuff. And all the stuff that gamers have been into for years, right? But that includes gaming, movies, you know, Sonic is pretty up there. We're seeing this transition from the comic book heroes movies to video game and technology, and that's cool. You know, I feel like that's, if anything, the influence of Hollywood is huge because it's too old. Because it has this way of kind of like skewing our perceptions. I will never forget how many people show up to Los Angeles and go like, "This is Los Angeles?" And it's like, "Yeah, motherfucker, those movies aren't real." You know? So if that is the way that technology will be influenced by Hollywood in the future, let's at least make it a good one, you know? Let's make it like legit shit. When people go like, "Yo, the book is better because it had this, this, and this," well, maybe we got to look at how we bring these gaming narratives and really adapt them to technology, adapt that technology and that style to filming. So, hey, lots of interesting plans over there by Sony. We'll get back to that in a few. That's a lot of topics today, aren't we?
Woo!
But why is it important, right? Why is it important? Okay. There's a lot of topics. I'm very happy today. I'm very excited today. We'll get through them. I'll start hurrying up. Why is it important to fund these projects? Why is it important to know exactly what these people deserve instead of just throwing money at, oh, superheroes has been hot for the past 10 years. Let's just keep on making superhero movies. Let's just keep on spending our money on shit that's not going to sell and freaking out when we can't find ways to make that revenue and bump our fucking prices to inflation because we don't understand how to invest and diversify. But the other side of the coin, man behind illegal streaming sites bigger than Netflix, Hulu, and Prime combined, convicted. One of the men facing maximum sentence of 48 years in prison, holy shit, by Eddie Macouch over at GameStop. The U.S. Department of Justice has announced that the federal jury in Las Vegas convicted 5 men recently of their roles in operating an illegal streaming service in the U.S. that was said to have more content than Netflix, Hulu, Prime, and Vudu combined. The service, Jeffflix, generated millions of subscription revenue. Oh, that's why it again wrecked. The DOJ said and caused substantial harm to the owners of the programming. Starting as early as 2007, Christopher Delman, Douglas Carson, Felipe Garcia, Jared Jacquery, and Peter Huber ran Jetflix. The DOJ said nothing of that the website used sophisticated computer scripts and software to find illegal copies of TV shows that were downloaded and hosted on Jetflix servers. The DOJ said the men reproduced hundreds of thousands of copyright television episodes without authorization, noting that Jetflix had tens of thousands of paying members. That's where the issues happen. Noting that the website used sophisticated computer scripts and software to find illegal copies. Interesting. The defenses conspired to operate an online streaming service that unlawfully reproduced and distributed thousands of copyrighted television programs for their own personal gain. U.S. Attorney U.S. Jason M. Frierson for the District of Nevada said that the new interlude released the case, quote, "The case is another example of our steadfast commitment to combat intellectual property theft and to hold accountable those who violate intellectual property rights laws." FBI Washington Field Office Assistant Director David Stunberg said that the defense tried to disguise Jetflix as an aviation of entertainment company after copyright holders began to take notice. Oh, aviation. Nice. Digital privacy is not a victimless crime. As these convictions demonstrate, the FBI will indeed investigate those who illegally profit from the creative works of others, Stunberg said. Specifically, Dahlman, Carson, Garcia, Jacquery, and Huber were convicted by a jury for a conspiracy to commit criminal copyright infringement. Dahlman himself was also convicted on 2 counts for money laundering and 3 counts for misdemeanor criminal copyright infringement. Carson, Garcia, Jacquery, and Huber are facing a maximum penalty of 5 years in prison, while Dahlman is facing maximum sentence, 48 years of prison. Damn. The government has not yet set a sentencing date. Variety reported that another member of the original group, Daryl Julius Polo, previously left Jetflix, started a competing site known as iStream It All, which also did not have a license for his content. Polo pleaded guilty in 2019 to criminal copyright and money laundering charges and received a sentence of 57 months in prison and was ordered to give up $1 million for criminal proceeds. Damn!
How about that one, eh? Yeah, well, universe gonna universe. It's gonna be one of those. It's cool.
I
think we're all kind of just here.
We're all just kind of working with what we got, and it gets me because, for example, I hear the music. It gets me because, like, you hear these companies doing all their stuff, right? It's cool. We have, like, multiple streaming services that, like, want to do something crazy and they want to have their own original programming and they all want to be, like, the next fucking Queen, what's that show called? Queen's Gambit. And I just saw that with my nephews yesterday. So, like, it's cool. I get that. You know, it's cool. I get it. But, like, again, like, bro, we're just fucking throwing money left and right to, like, hopefully we land on something. We're just gambling on all these fucking numbers and colors without having a direction. And, like, in the long term, it sucks because you diversify so much that it turns people off when you're trying to be like, hey, man, well, I got a new service that you can join for $10.99. And it's like, bro, fuck off. We're already paying up the ass for all this bullshit. Like, why are you going to fucking separate Knuckles from the rest of the other crew just to get your fucking streaming service? You know? So, like, it's rough. It's shitty. It sucks that, like, as much as I would love to binge HBO Max and watch all these Warner Brothers shows and movies, like historical films, Hubert and shit, I know that I wouldn't have the time to, like, indulge in that. So why the fuck would I pay $20 a month to not watch it or to watch it once a month? You know what I mean? It's ludicrous. But we get here and we see these people trying to, like, find other solutions or quote-unquote creative solutions. But, man, that's just profit. That's other people freaking stealing, generating profit from a different angle. But we'll just have to wait and see how the universe reacts. Don't worry about it. Woo. Because it's crazy out there. Ladies and gentlemen, did you know it's fucking crazy out there? How crazy? Woman caught smuggling 350 Nintendo Switch games in her bruh. Games were confiscated and estimated to be worth around 9,660. And you know it ends at 60 AO 96. Because it's $60 games worth. But it's not the whole case, right? It's just the freaking cartridges. 350 is some bullshit. Let's find out. A nervous Hong Kong Kotaku. A nervous woman with a large bus stop was stopped in an airport in China after officials grew suspicious. They inspected her and discovered she was allegedly trying to smuggle 350 Nintendo Switch carts out of the country by stuffing them into her bra. As spotted by me, we never lost the world. No. This is by Zach Zwayzen. Hey, yo. Over at Kotaku. Kotaku with the interesting topics, huh? As spotted by Tom Hondwards on June 14th, reported by Yahoo. A woman trying to leave Hong Kong and enter China via Liantang port was stopped by customs officers after they noticed she was acting strange. It seemed nervous, and she had oddly shaped breasts during routine inspection of travelers. She was taken to a private area, and officials reportedly found that she was trying to smuggle over 300 Switch cartridges in her brassiere, likely explaining her odd behavior and strange shape of her bust. I laughed at the idea of people just staring at, like, the weird shape and being like, yeah, I'm just going to let her go. I don't want to touch that. I wouldn't touch that with a 50-foot pole. All right. Officials confiscated the 350 Nintendo Switch cards from the women's bra. Oh, they were just cards. It's estimated that the value of all the games is around 7,000 yuan, or about 9,660 US dollars. In China, Article 7, Regulations and Implementation of Customs, Administrative Punishment of People's Republics of China prohibits people from evading customs by hiding, disguising, or concealing declarations, false declarations, or other means, transportation, carrying, or mailing goods that are prohibited or restricted from entry or exit by the state. And likely, and like in most cases, countries bringing in goods without paying the necessary taxes is illegal. There you go. And consider smuggling. Oh, taxes. Yeah, tariffs and all that shit. It's pointed out by Tom's Hardware, assuming the Switch cards aren't considered restricted by China. A woman suspected of smuggling games in her bra is unlikely to sell jail time. Instead, she could be fined. Not more than three times the amount of duties payable, but evaded. Not more than three times the amount of duties payable, but evaded. Now, for folks out there who wear or have access to bras, also a bunch of Switch games, here's my challenge to you. Just, that's irrelevant. it's getting in and beginning with, sounds hard enough. You have to get out of the way and blah, 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 blah. It's like normal, I'm sure you can do it, blah, 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 blah. I guess neither could the woman caught by Chinese. Look, she only got caught because she was acting nervous. That's real talk, that's pretty much it. Also, like, if she had maybe tried 250, she could have gone, oh yeah, because they're plastic wrapped. They're like in little Ziploc packets. Well, so Sally can wait. She knows it's too late that she's walking on by. Sorry for not fucking having the audio last week.
That was really shit.
At least I think it's up this week, but hey. Wish me luck. Hi, it's G. It's your boy. Hey, wish me luck. And so, that's when the thingy fell. Hello. Oh, the moon is back. Don't worry about it. The full moon went away. Strawberry moon is this weekend, by the way. So, if you have a chance to look up at the sky, that was on Friday. We might start losing that full moon now. Victor. Okay. We're almost there. It's a bit of a rougher one on the newsletters. Because yeah. All right, here you go. This is by Egan Lowe over at Anime News Network. Voice actor Toru Furuya steps down from Detective Conan, One Piece roles. Voice actor admitted to 4-year affair with acknowledged what? Abused last month. This is rough. I didn't know it was that intense. I thought it was just going to be Detective Conan. I thought it was going to be a good one. Whoa, fuck. I think I did see about this earlier. Talent agency at Aoni Production and voice actor Toru Furuya jointly announced on Saturday that Furuya has stepped down from the roles of Toru Amaru in the Detective Conan franchise and Sabo in the One Piece franchise. Sabo is, I don't know any of these people. Aoni Production added that it had asked Furuya to step down and Furuya obliged. Furuya himself added that he apologized for the great burden and he caused for all involved. Damn. Atlas announced on June 11 that it had removed Furuya from the cast of the upcoming Metaphor ReFantasia. That's coming out soon. Oh no, that's in June, or that's in October. Damn. Role-playing game, due to various circumstances, and will announce the replacement cast member sometime in July. Atlas has not previously announced which character role Furuya would be playing in this game. Let's find out what this guy says. Toru Amawo. Is it like the older dude? Do, 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 do. It's Detective Dude. Hey! Damn. Sucks. It's rough. Oh, yeah, and he dresses like him, too. That's hilarious. This kind of looks like Reagan. Is this like the Reagan of Detective Conan? Or is Reagan supposed to be based off of this guy? Okay. I've never seen Detective Conan. Lupin the Third Dio. Hi. On his ex, formerly known as Twitter. Count 22nd, voice actor Toru Furuya acknowledged on a recent report by Weekly Bushin magazine regarding an affair he had with a fan. Weekly Bushin interviewed him for the article. Furuya admitted that he had been in a relationship with a female fan for 4.5 years, damn. The last attempt, that's a relationship, dog. And he said that he had become attracted to a fan of his who was supporting him earnestly and that he had contacted her to begin the affair. He also admitted that during the relationship, he had raised his hand to strike her once when they had an argument. Furuya also admitted that he had caused the woman to have an abortion. Whoa, fuck. Following his admission, anime canceled its Detective Conan event scheduled for 27th. Damn. Which would have him as a speaker. Damn it. He also left the stage reading pre-production scheduled for August 10th to 11th.
Rio's voice acting career extends more than 15 years. Holy shit. He has performed more than 100 titles. He is known for voicing characters such as Tuxedo Mask, Sailor Moon. Okay, that's what I thought. Amura Rain, Rolls of Gundam, Yamcha, and Dragon Ball. Yamcha, Toru Amaru, Rei Furia, and Tickle Coleman. Same person. And his anime roles also include Sabo in One Piece, Pegasus Seiya and Saint Seiya, Kyosuke Kagura and Kigamori, Orange Road, and Ribbon's Allmark in Mobile Gundam. Wow. What a bummer, man. I know Japan has a good amount of infidelity when it comes to, like, having, like, local establishments where you can do sketchy shit, and I never really understood why, like, the wives don't, or let that happen, you know what I mean? Like, far be it for me to, like, explain the rules of marriage to anybody, you know? But, like, if you're not vibing with the person, aside from divorcing and money and finance and all this other bullshit, you know, if you know your boy is doing all this shit, like, sketchily, and you are hoping to change that, or you want to connect, or you want to reestablish, or you want to work on things, why not talk about it? You know, why not communicate and be like, hey man, what's wrong? Why do you not feel this way? Or what about going over there makes you feel that way, or brings you excitement, or like X amount of things? And if it is an issue of like attraction, is there no way to instigate more attraction? Or is it just like a done deal? Or they do that? And man, I don't know. It's rough out there. It really is. All right. Well, just stay cool. Keep your head on your shoulders. You know, think with your brain, not with your penis. And be nice to your wife, dog. I think at the end of the day, well, be nice to the mother of your children. How about that one? Because you never know. Yeah, so we'll figure that one out. But hey, man, just be cool out there. Okay. All right. But hey, you know what else is cool? Koei Tecmo begins building game theme park in Yokohama. It's by Rafael Antonio Pineda over at Anime News Network. Theme park plans to open in July 2027. Real estate company Koyu announced on Tuesday that it began construction of a video game theme park named the Great Art Museum. Nice! In Yokohama's Minato Mirai future area. In February, with the park planned to finish by May 2027 and open in July 2027. The committee did not reveal the details on the attractions for the park, but it revealed that the game art museum building itself will be a spiral shape and have three floors. The park will also include an art garden that will use foliage and projection mapping to portray game world. Nice. This area will also include an office building with 29 floors and two basement floors. Koyu is an affiliate of game company Koei Tecmo Holdings, with parent company of game developer and publisher Koei Tecmo Games, Nobunaga's Mission Warrior series, and Atelier series. Koei Tecmo Games headquarters building itself is located in the Minato Mirai area. Cool. Right. So, again, we're seeing technology expand, be different, create, and just kind of like really open up to be like, hey, all these things, cool. Ouch. All these things, cool. How can we make more money? And sure, that's scary if we're focusing on that. But also we get to the point where like, well, how can we create new entertainment? How can we what other services can we provide to our video game fanatics, our fans, our industry darlings, you know? Like, what can we do for them? Art dayo. So that's cool to think about. We see this building a game theme park in Yokohama, so that means like it's like a
maybe not necessarily like a theme park as we know, like Six Flags and all that other stuff, Disneyland and whatnot, with roller coasters, but more of a park inside a building that's themed around video games and the environment and all that. And I think that's cool. I think that could be an interesting way to really bring this immersive experience to the hardest fans who really love the art that's being made by these developers. And that symbiotic relationship, or that relationship in itself, feels like natural and beautiful, because you're supporting each other in the creation of art. So, hey, man, I hope it does well. And, hey, man, I hope I can go to Japan by sometime in the future and check that out. Unless Universal gets intense. Woo! All right. Universal revives Dark Universe as a theme park. What? It's alive! Again. This time at Universal's Epic Universe. Where is that at? Universal's ambitious plan to take on the likes of Disney and Marvel with its Dark Universe extended cinematic universe might not have turned out as expected, but you can't keep a good monster down for long, especially when you can revive the brand as a new theme park attraction. The film studio has announced that it'll open five new attractions at Epic Universe, the upcoming latest theme park at Universal Orlando Resort, all based on its iconic movie monster franchises, Dracula, the Wolfman, Frankenstein's monsters, the Bride of Frankenstein, and a new generation of monsters and characters can be seen in Dark Moor, a ravaged village set inside a dark universe. Wow, I'm actually getting chills. All right, that's new. Hi, what do we got? Ooh. Pause. Oh no, I'm good. I was actually really worried about that. Ooh. Run. Inside Dark Moor, guests can visit Frankenstein's Manor and meet Dr. Victoria Frankenstein. Cute. Who is conducting a few sinister experiments. As part of the Monsters Unchained, Frankenstein. Who is... That's intense. That's pretty intense. It's like Hogwarts, but spooky. Oh, man. So it's like... kind of reminds you of, what's his face? Mario. Super Mario. The castle, Bowser's Castle, or where you do the Mario Karting. It's kind of like Bowser's Castle. That's so fucking creepy. And we got the little rise and shit. Oh, little spiral thingy. Hey, yo. Who is conducting a few sinister experiments as part of his Monsters Unchained Frankenstein experiment ride. This creepy tour will see Dracula, the Wolfman, the Mummy, and Creature from the Black Lagoon, and the brides of Dracula escape their cages and chase after guests. Curse of the Werewolf is a spinning family coaster inspired by Wolfman and takes place in a forest full of creatures, cursed creatures. Nice. If you feel like getting into the spirit of things, you can have your face painted in a Dark Moor monster makeup experience, temporarily transform into one of your favorite monsters. Other attractions include eateries like the Steakhouse, the Lacey's Cottage, nice, and the Burning Blade Tavern, themed restaurants full of vampires, nice, Frankenstein's monsters and hunters. Universal says a new section will open up in 2025. It's part of Epic Universe. That's cool. Actually, not that bad. All right. Epic Universe, cute. Epic Universe, hey yo, there's that. Dark Universe film franchise officially kicked off in May 2017. The official cast photo featured Russell Crowe, Tom Cruise, Sofia Boutella, Javier Bardem, and Johnny Depp. Cruise, Crowe, and Boutella all starred in The Mummy, a film that was set to debut a month after an infamous photo was taken, while Depp, Bardem would have starred in remakes of Invisible Man and Bride of Frankenstein, respectively. Sadly, The Mummy wasn't successful enough for Universal. It made $400 million worldwide, and Universal switched gears to focus on solo stories instead of interconnected movies, leading to Jason Blum and Blumhouse Productions producing a critical and commercial remake of The Invisible Man. I saw that. That was actually really good. Yeah. Yep. Without Johnny Depp. Interesting. So I had no idea that we could have had Johnny Depp as the Invisible Man. But I saw that. It was pretty cool. All right. Well, we're seeing this new development of attractions. We've heard talks about Sony wanting to do anime parks, theme parks. And we're seeing Universal adapt video games and now adapt more of a Dark Universe angle. So it's cool to see that. It's curious to see how they're gonna like make that a thing. But what gets me most, real talk, is that they low-key basically made the spooky mansion from Final Fantasy over at the Golden Saucer like a reality. So, wow, we're there. That's cool. But no, all in all, I think it's going to be awesome. I know a shitload of people would really pop off for like this darky, edgy vibe of a hotel and a park and a theme park and like a spooky theme park, I think, could really make a big deal. So that's crazy to think about how not only can we maybe get like movie and superhero theme parks, but now we're going into like the full spooky territory. And the idea of a Golden Saucer is just that much closer. So hey, never know. Looking very cool out there. Woo! So speaking of cool, the coolest, some would say. GameStop. Summer Games Fest is over. You know, not E3 is over. But we had one final heavy hitter. Shortstop, you know? Good shit. Here's everything we saw at today's Nintendo Direct. So we won't go through all of them, but we're going to go through the big ones. So this is by Claire Jackson. Published on Tuesday. Hi. Mario and Luigi team up again. Zelda must save Link. Samus is back, baby. Today, June 14th, 2024, Nintendo Direct may not have everything we had wanted to say. Sorry, Silkson. But damn, did I have some great-looking games. Coming to Nintendo's hybrid console. Yes, we got Metroid Prime 4, but there's so much more. Yeah, we'll go through it quickly. Mario & Luigi is a freaking game that I am so in love with. The Mario & Luigi series is one of my all-time favorites. I'll never forget fucking playing on the Game Boy Advance, running out of batteries, being on the final boss fight, and be like, oh shit. But we fucking got it, dog. We beat that game, and that was really it. That was the game that made me go, you know what? RPGs are fucking cool. And yeah, aside from Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic on Xbox, like, this game really made me, oh, and the art style looks amazing. Oh my god. It's so cool. I want this so bad. Yeah, so like, we'll see. Oh, because he's lighter. He's shorter. And yeah, so we're going to have some voice acting fun with that one then as well. We'll probably have to do a playthrough of Superstar Saga, which is the first game in this series. And I would love to do a playthrough of Superstar Saga. But that requires me to... too nice. That requires me to not so fucking cool to really get grinding and finish Paper Mario, and B, if I really want to do Mass Effect, then I gotta really pace myself with these guys. But holy shit, this looks cool. I'm so about it. Oh my god, I can't wait for this. Weedy.
Wish you were.
I ain't a pick.
Okay. Nintendo opened up with the show with Mario & Luigi Brothership, featuring an almost but not quite cel-shaded graphics, signature platforming, and even some RPG combat elements. It was hard to keep off with many different sights and sounds of what's in offer to this game. Nintendo World's Champion, NES Edition. Make sure you go have some of that. Time for a nice throwback with 13 different Nintendo NES games with a variety of genres. This collection looks like an excellent way for you to put up your retro skills to challenge and brag to your friends. Fairy Tail 2, which is a cool little thing. I didn't know that the first game did not finish the storyline, But dude, I am so down to jump into the second final half of Fairy Tail. An anime adaptation of RPG form, Fairy Tail features real-time combat and one variety of different environments. Fairy Tail 2 is expected this winter. I will be down to play the shit out of that. You guys see the, well, you guys know the tattoos I have, so that makes reason. Fantasia Neo Dimension. Fantasia Neo sees Final Fantasy Legends Sakaguchi Anu Matsu Gorgeous RPG arriving on Switch Holiday 2024. That's pretty cool. Nintendo Switch Sports Basketball. Making its journey from the Wii to the Switch, Sports Basketball finds its way to Switch as a free update to Nintendo Sports. Offers 2v2 local and online multiplayer. I should get into Switch Sports. Neo! Memories in Orbit. Somber music, mysterious looking protagonists, beautiful environments, and delightful looking platform combat. No, it's not Hollow Knight. It's Mio Memories in Orbit. Arrives in 2025. Or Silk Song, sorry. Illusions update. Mickey Mouse really needs your help. Thank you. Needs your help. And this update for Illusion Island with an all new mystery to solve. The update expected to arrive later today on June 18th. Hello Kitty Island Adventure. Actually, I want to see the graphics on this. It's going open world. Aren't you excited? Hello Kitty Island Adventure arrives early in 2025. And Animal Crossing fans should enjoy this one. Oh, wow, this looks. Oh, is that Gretzko? Hey, yo. Kawaii. Looney Tunes, Wacky World of Sports. We got some Mario Sports in here, but with Looney Tunes, not bad. With four-player local co-op and classic Warner Bros. Characters, Looney Tunes, Wacky World of Sports looks like an arcade-themed blast. We're halfway through. Let's go. Moogus update. Update introduces new character types, jazz up the wildly successful detection formula, and new update arrives later today on June 18th. Farmagia. It's not two again. Time to farm and raise monsters that will follow you in battle against the evil tyrant in Underworld. Felicidad arrives on Switch November 1st. Who the fuck wrote this? Felicidad is Donkey Kong Country Returns HD. Ayo, people like that one. Some evil fool has stolen Donkey Kong's banana hoard, and we can't let that stand. Featuring classic side-scrolling action across 8 levels, play over 2-player local co-op. Donkey Kong Country Returns HD arrives on January 16th. January babies, rise up. Dragon Quest 3 HD. Hell the fuck. Yes. Time to go back to Dragon Quest 3, and this time is lovely HD 2D remake. Arrives on November 1st. Damn, do I love that HD remake look. Yeah, this looks fucking cool. I would love to try that. I'd be so down for this. So cool. Dragon Quest 1 and 2 remakes. Hey, yo. So the briefest announcements for Return of Dragon Quest 2, 1 and 2. These remakes are expected to arrive next year, 25. Don't worry, Plane 3 is first true to canonical order. Yes. So 3... 1 and then 2, I guess. Makes sense. Funko Fusion. Oh, it's fucking Ramona Flowers. Wow. Hey, are you tired of Funko Pops? I can possibly. Well, Funko Fusion is coming to Switch on September 13th, 2024. Offers a variety of collect series like Jurassic World and Battlestar Galactica. Shaun of the Dead. It's hilarious. Oh, yeah, it was Scott Brogan. Nice. Luigi's Mansion 2 HD. Okay, time to partner up with Luigi and yet again return to Luigi's Mansion 2, the remaster. The new Dempa Man. Battles, Island Farming, and 4-player co-op. Dempa Man is free title expected to drive in July Switch 2022. Metal Slug Attack Reloaded. Driving today, Metal Slug Reloaded Remix Class Series looks at the Tower Defense game. Game is available now, so go play some or something. Darkest Dungeon. Returns with a sequel that looks as dark as full of dungeons as we expected to. Or Darkest Dungeon 2. GBA Advance and N64 remakes. Rich Friends, Lynch of Zelda, Link to Past, Mentor Zero, Missions, Turok, Dinosaur Hunter, and Perfect Dark. Hell yeah, arriving on Switch later today. Phantom Brave, The Lost Hero, featuring turn-based combat, a quest to save your best friend. Phantom Brave, latest game, arrives 2025. And one of my personal favorites, Marvel vs. Capcom Fighting Collection. Arcade Classics. This is going to be fucking legit. With 7 arcade fighters packed in a single installment, online PvP and co-op, Marvel vs. Capcom arrives on Switch later this year. I'll take you for a ride, Dio. Okay, and Super Mario Party Jamboree. Hope you're ready to party because Mario and pals are sure are. Featuring a wide variety of new party minigames, some classic challenges. Jamboree arrives on October 17th. And Legend of Zelda Echoes of Wisdom. Some absolutely gorgeous visuals. A boy named Link gone missing. It's time to play as Zelda herself. But Girlie ain't down with swinging swords. Instead, she's
to take ownership of the tri rod, a magical item that lets her create echoes of objects and investigate and to navigate the world and duplicate tons of objects. The monsters fight for her. You go, girl boss. Echoes of Wisdom arrives on December 26, 24. Along with the brand new Zelda theme Switch Lite. Cute. Just Dance. Hey, do you like dancing? I sure as hell don't, but maybe you do. Good thing Just Dance 2025 Edition arrives on Switch and discovered those same eerie visuals. We saw LEGO Horizons Adventure during Summer Games Fest this year. And yeah, it still looks super freaking cool. I mean, don't you want to smash up Robo Dryness with LEGO Bricks and POW Online locally? Or LEGO Horizons by the Switch and PS5 and Holiday 2025. Stray portaling over from the PS3. Kitty is going portable with Stray on Nintendo Switch. Okay. Tells of the Shire, Lord of the Rings game. Well, it's funny to imagine Shire under brutal assault from Sauron. Maybe a nice chill Hobbit sim where you get to share bountiful meals with the Hobbit friends. It's a bit nicer. Yeah. Animal Crossing now. I can name. And finally, not finally, but hey, two cool ones. Ace Attorney Investigations. Hell yes. Miles for the win. Let's go. With the power of logic, you two can crack the tough cases of the world of Ace Attorney with both modern and retro-style graphics. Ace Attorney Investigations Collections arrive on September 6th. That is one that we will definitely be playing. I would love to play that shit. He's wearing red, damn it. He's in our team. And one that I'm freaking excited the fuck about from Danganronpa team. One day you're just having a nice stroll with a pal in a pretty city. The next you're running for your life and from where to destroying everything. The 100 Line, Last Defense Academy, tasks you with defending your school from swarms of freaks ready to pillage and murder. That's cool. I look forward to this. No, 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 no. Ow. Scary. Yeah. Let's look into that. No. It's a ghost guy. It's a ghost guy. It's the other girl's dad. And then Romancing Saga. One day you're ready to pillage and murder. Romance Design Edition, you have a comfort following timeline, battles, and function merchandise mechanics that lead you to strategize your path in battle. Oh, it looks actually really well developed. Oh, Romance and Saga is one that people like, huh? Metroid, and finally, Metroid Prime 4 Beyond. Fuck yeah. So we still haven't beaten Metroid Prime, but hell yeah! Our girl Samus is finally back in first person. Today's Nintendo Disc Direct treated some gameplay from the upcoming FPS, and it looks too good to resist. Metroid Prime 4 is expected to arrive in 2025. Yeah, it looks really fucking clean. Look at that shit. Hell yeah. Like, more phonetic, huh? I feel like giving you, like, dash mechanics and all that probably worked out. I'm curious to see how the Metroid suit looks in updated graphics and all that shit. Look at her go. Hell yeah. Girl boss. All right. And that was everything for the Nintendo Direct. June's Nintendo Direct. But yeah, you know what isn't cool? Well, depending on who you ask. Because, according to Zach Zwayzen over in Kotaku, new Marvel vs. Capcom collection, latest game to also skip Xbox. On June 18th, Capcom revealed that it's porting the beloved arcade fighter Marvel vs. Capcom 2 as well as 6 other Marvel arcade games to modern consoles, but the new collection won't be released on Xbox consoles, continuing a tread that has some Xbox fans worried. During today's massive Nintendo Direct, Capcom announced Marvel vs. Capcom Fighting Collection Arcade Classics, a new retro bundle of popular fighting and brawling games, as mentioned earlier. And includes Marvel vs. Capcom 2, a true fan-favorite pixel art fighting game from 2000 that hasn't received a proper console port in over a decade. I still have it downloaded on my PS3 IO. So a lot of people are extremely excited to play MVC 2 on all the games on this new bundle. However, Xbox players won't have to watch from the sidelines. As confirmed by Capcom, MVC Fighting Collection won't be available on PlayStation 4, Switch, and PC. This has been noted by Xbox fans online who aren't happy about this decision.
This is why your fans are pissed, because when Xbox moves games to other platforms, we still don't get games going to Xbox in 2024.
Tweeted one of the totally non-angry players in response to Capcom Sweet, company lack of Xbox support.
Wow.
Because when Xbox moves games. Thank you for writing. Steam. Hey, yo. Kotaku has reached out to Capcom and Xbox. MVC Fighting Collection is far from the first game to skip Xbox in the last 2 years. Mega Man Battle Network. You guys don't have Legacy? You guys got fucking wrecked. Sorry, no offense. Collection Final Fantasy Pixel Remastered. Damn, I didn't get those, dude. Great Ace Attorney Chronicles, I have that. And Monster Hunter Stories and Gundam Breaker 4 have also skipped Microsoft console.
way. What the hell is up with that? Somebody explain that one to me. Like run games, Limited Run Games, famous for remasters and physical ports of older titles, has also occasionally skipped Xbox. In early 2024, two games, Felix the Cat and Rocket Knight Adventures, resparked only rise on PlayStation and Switch. Limited Run CEO explained on Twitter that this decision was made because Xbox gamers just don't buy many physical games.
Ooh.
There was also the weird situation Resident Evil 4's Fancy 2023 remake, which skipped Xbox One, but still arrived on PS4. The horror remake did arrive on Series X, however, so it didn't fully skip Microsoft's home console. Still, Xbox One. Got it. Still, it's becoming more and more common for third-party games to skip Xbox. This lines up with the previous report that suggested some publishers aren't sure if it's still worth releasing games from Microsoft's home console anymore due to the low sales and Game Pass competition.
Damn!
Of course, it should be noted that big games like Grand Theft Auto V, Battlefield 2042, Suicide Squad, Star Wars Jedi Survivor, and still launch on Xbox alongside other platforms. So it's not like the other consoles going to only stop getting new third-party releases. But if this trend continues, it could make it harder for Xbox to sell consoles, as players worry their favorite franchises will be available on Microsoft's devices in the future. That's very interesting to think about, because not only is it... See, at first I thought it was Capcom like making secret moves with PlayStation and being like, oh, we got partnerships and stuff up the butt. So that's why we don't port those, which actually is Capcom. But you're throwing in the other games too, so it's like more than just the one, right?
No.
Tell him like there's the cursor. Grace Eternity, that's all Capcom. Final Fantasy is the only Square Enix one that they pod. So it is Square Enix and Capcom. So I think it really is those marketing deals that PlayStation is having. But also, very important to note that behind the scenes, they're saying that because of the Game Pass, it makes less sense as a third-party developer to produce for Xbox, because the user's tendency is to go straight to the Game Pass, which is all their free games. So most people will be like, well, why the fuck would I want to pay for this game on Xbox when I can just play any of these other games for free, quote-unquote, on my Netflix free? Which originally sounds like a great idea for Xbox. Well, sounds like an idea for Xbox, but when you put it into perspective that now the third-party developers are looking at the console and being like, well, no, it's not really worth it, they've isolated themselves in a corner, and now they're going to have to figure that one out. Huh. I assume it has more to do with the Japanese development because of all the marketing and like how the in-between international sales get affected, but dude, that's pretty crazy to think about. Keep that one in your back pocket. Cool. Moving on. And then just a quick little shout out. I just really wanted to shout out the homies over at Danganronpa. Good stuff. This is by Alex Mateo over at Anime Newsroom Network. Direct stream with a new adventure strategy game, 100 Line Last Defense. Zero Escape, AI, Stone Moon Files. By Danganronpa Master Detectives. And yeah, since we're high off of Raincode, I just want to make sure that we're like really hyped. Whoa, chill out there, kid. The story follows a teenager, Tsukimo, after a monster attack, mysterious school mascot forces Takumi to enroll in the Last Effective Academy, along with 1,500 students, their mission is to defend school for 100 days. Shit. Most famous writer for Spank Shop's Danganronpa Adventure Game series, the game last installment, V3 Killing Harmony, shipped in 2017. Damn, good times. Also wrote the survival scenario for Danganronpa and Peep, Ends of Help's future arc, and Danganronpa and Despair arc. The 2016 anime series that served as conclusion to the first two games in the series was good shit. Kodokawa was the director and scenario writer for Tokyo Game's Death Come True live action movie game. Nice. He also credited with the origin story concept for Katsuki and Tokyo Game's new Tribe 9 project, which includes an anime.
Ushiko co-writes Infinity Vision novel series, including Number 7, Ever 17, Remember 11. He debuted as director and inspections of Nine of Hours, Nine Personas, Nine Persons, Nine Doors. That's classic. First of the company's Zero Escape series, which includes Virtue's Last Reward and Zero Times Low. He also penned scripts for the Punchline anime. Punchline. Oh, I love Punchline. That's a good one. As well as the PSP and video games adaptation. That's so cool. Yeah, I love this guy then. Dude, Punchline is such an old callback. Shit, that. But yeah, looking forward to seeing more development. I think we're going to... Maybe I'm getting too... what do you call it? Ambitious. But I do hope they continue the whole universe combining of worlds. We saw how Zero Escape kind of links up with Danganronpa in terms with how that factory towards the end is where the robot, the PALS, the Danganronpa robot bear was developed. So there's that little tidbit. We'll have to wait and see what these guys have in store for us. But hey, man, tower defense and cool anime characters, I'm all in. By one of the most prolific writers, I guess, in my era, I would like that. Sugiwa. And here, running down the last roll. Okay, this is a bummer. It's by George Yang over at GameStop.com. Sony shutting down this rewards program. Here, deadline for submitting claims revealed that it would be ending the rewards program offered through its Sony and PlayStation brand credit cards, which is what I have. 2044. Website with mobile location will shut down on December 21st. Users have until then to redeem any points and access on their account, as well as submit any bonus points to purchase credit request forms in the app. However, after July 21st, holy shit. Fuck. That's in a month. We'll no longer be able to mail physical bonuses or purchase credit request forms. Confused with Sony's Stars program, which is PlayStation's loyalty and digital collectors program. Sony rewards program involves using Sony and PlayStation via credit cards to acquire points in order to redeem such as electronic credit PAs and store codes. PlayStation credit card was first installed in 2017. Microsoft recently used the Xbox credit card last year with MasterCard, which instantly became available to everyone outside of Xbox Insider Program. It offers perks such as Game Pass Ultimate subscriptions for spending a certain amount of money within the first 12 months of opening the account. Interesting times. I got this card back in the day. I have a fairly good score, so I can choose to be stupid and, like, you know, dick around when it comes to these things. But it's crazy to see how, like, a company that is looking to make money in different areas looks at the development, the time, and everything that happened, and goes like, "Nah, dog, nah, we're pulling out, we're done." So it's crazy to see how those fools have tried this. I guess they're not getting rid of the card; they're just getting rid of the rewards. Basically, every time you pay for your internet or you basically buy anything on PSN, you get points added to your account, and you can buy a $50 credit, PSN credit, which is really, really awesome. I think it was, real talk, one of the best deals because of how often you were just like investing in yourself when it comes to games. So to see that they low-key can't keep up with this anymore, and the money isn't there and all that BS, it's kind of a bummer, man. It's kind of a bummer. But hey, I had my fun and I got my money, and they now I owe them credit. So they got what they wanted. All right. No. Yes, sir.
Just so you know that we know that you know.
Just so you know that we know that you know. Metallica doing their thing. Fortnite's Metallica concert. How to watch and start times. Did that happen already? Saturday, June. That was yesterday. 7 a.m. PT. Oh, you can watch it today at 11 PT. That happened already. And 2 p.m. PT. That's going to happen in 15 minutes. Wow, look at you guys. I said the middle of the concert, I've just longed Fortnite during the formation times, like Metallica Fuel Fire and Fire Discover and Fortnite, and then enjoy the show. Every 30 minute one after times, you can still access the concert. Those are three friends who can join you. Concert will feature six Metallica songs for the band's illustrious decade spanning catalog, created by VR, AR, Metaverse Studio Magnus, which built experience for Fortnite. If you've barely seen Fortnite concerts like those from Travis Scott, Aaron Garner, you know what to expect for an audiovisual spectacle. Concert will be played across the states, concludes, so be sure, make sure to take time. Sounds good. It's probably going to be a good time. But for Metallica and other Fortnite devotees, there's a lot more metal bands influence to be found all over the game. First off, new season's Fortnite Festival is all about metal band. You can meet more at the Caverns Festival. In Battle Royale's Rebel, you find no traversal item, weapon, the ride, lightning guitars. Very cool. Smashing Metallica Cup will take place before the competitive current again on June 18th. Give you time to win Ringer Remote for the late season. Over Rocket Racing, you can brand new check. Okay, that's fine. TLDR. You can get them in legal form. TLDR. Metallica has been represented very well throughout the history. I think about Guitar Hero Metallica when that came out and how they did a little commercial. They're like, you thought we'd let those guys dance in their underwear for our commercial? Yeah, that was them. So to see them come all the way over to Fortnite and just kind of like do, I don't want to say sell out, but low key that you're selling your image to them. So low key by definition. But okay, man. Okay. Travis Scott, creative, interesting. I don't keep up with his stuff, so I was like, whatever, Cactus Jack, go eat a burger, go eat a Big Mac or something. And then Ariana Grande, obviously I'm not never really been associated with her, not really into her music per se, but it's there. Metallica, holy shit, Metallica. Now we're talking. So interesting to see how they are bringing in more bands, and if this is going to continue to be a trend, like if this is going to be our future where we will begin to see all these bands show up in these video games. And well, Fortnite is a special exception because it really is the video game that has everything inside of it. But you know, if there's other companies like Sony, who's fucking excited, quote unquote, about opening new revenue streams and trying to do like all their music, all their video games, all their anime, all their movies, try to do something different. Maybe not exactly like Fortnite, but maybe a digital or virtual meetup spot or virtual venue where you can experience these things. If that is like what is going to be in the future, then I think it's not that bad of a way to go. I think it's be cool. So we'll have to see if that's going to change or be something unique to us in the future. Hey, man. As long as these music, video games, and movies and anime kind of keep on forming into the singularity, keep on getting absorbed into one singularity, it's just another Tuesday for me, bros. It's all good. So, looking forward to see how this changes in the future and how exciting, how well accepted this becomes. Because now I'm curious. I'm going to try to load this up as we get there. So, I'll get back to you on that one. But hi. Finally, one on the list. This is just a cute little note by your boy. Ghost in the Shell 2, Innocence 4K release is a sight to see by Kalai Cheek. Or Anime News Network. G-Kids is bringing Mamoru Oishi's Ghost in the Shell 2 Innocence to theaters from June 23rd to 26th in celebration of its 20th anniversary. It follows 2021 limited theatrical run of 4K remaster of director Oishi's 1995 Ghost in the Shell, which was screened in IMAX theaters. However, the distribution was overseen by Bandai Lionsgate in partnership with Videots. G-Kids hosted a screening at the organization's Eagle Rock Theater, where fans and movie buffs alike lined up early to be one of the first to see the remaster. Damn. Hell yes. New 4K experience spectacularly upholds Oishi's directorial vision and highlights the ingenuity of the movie's animation and sound design. Despite being two decades old, the film's missions on human reliance and technology and the human obsession with the past resonate now more than they did in 2004. As a personal antidote, I watched Oishi's two Ghost in the Shell movies as a teenager and have found renewed appreciation for him as a filmmaker now as an adult. Before the screen, I watched my ordered copies on a modest TV screen and sound system, which pales in comparison to a theatrical screen with a crowd. Dope.
Addressing the elephant in the room, the uncannies of the computer graphics and the sound animation are now even more jarring in 4K than they were in 1080p. However, this fits into Oishi's intentions, as he stated his motivations to push animation to its limits back during 2004 press conference at the Cannes Films Festival, that's Canada. Now see individual faces within a sea of background characters, which draws an even starker line between 3D and 2D animation. Of course, certain aspects don't stand the test of time, such as limitations of 3D detailing. For example, simple smooth model of Togusa's car almost floats on top of a highly detailed background, like oil on water. That's an Inkuba song. Panoramic scene views are lifelike and immersive, almost as if the viewer can touch the individual flaps of the tilt-rotor. The parade sequence becomes a cognitive overload as the faces of and moving bodies are mesmerizing to watch, almost as if the viewer is looking into someone's recollection of memory. His visual character interactions and smooth movements are enriched further with the 4K restoration. Bato and Togusa's endless repeating journey in the maze-like Locus Coelius building was an animation marvel at the time, but now it's even more of a spectacle to see to a dizzying degree. Even twitch at the unnerving jerky steps that Kim takes as he speaks to Togusa. Most notably, the movie brings in life in Kenji Kawai's sound and music composition. During the scenes in Kim's dollhouse, the reverberations within the eerie score of Dollhouse 1 and Dollhouse 2 entrap the viewer alongside Togusa and Bato in the mansion. Since the music box tune was originally recorded in Stone Quarry, the enhanced echoes in the 4K version create an intense atmosphere along with an overwhelming visuals. I left feeling trapped like a miniature doll in a movie's echoey space. All in all, this 4K restoration is a must-see for both Ghost in the Shell fans and cinephiles in 2024. Still only close to 8 cinephiles. In 2024 is only closer, only 8 years away from the movie setting in 2032. But the world of Ghost in the Shell 2 Innocence, still an everlasting visual marvel. Cool. And that will be available for today. I'm gonna check this movie times, but I believe I might be able to go watch that one today. I want to go see it on the IMAX screen, so I'm gonna try to take advantage of that if I can. Oh, South Park is out right now. Ghost in the Show, whoop. My way. It's a 4 p.m. showing. Good lord. I'll take it. I did it my way. Zimman. Okay, go back to you. 4K. 4K. No. Okay, I'll do that. Yep, Japanese. My dear, I'll say it clear. I got my ticket. 4 p.m. today at my AMC. Hey, yo. Okay, so I will get back to you on that and tell you how I feel while we stream Stellar Blade or something like that. But that's going to be it for today. I think I've never seen the second Ghost in the Shell. Sorry about that. I've never seen the second Ghost in the Shell, so I'm very excited to experience this for my first time. 4K, awesome.
I love it. I'll take it.
And aside from that, I think we're ready to go. So AI, man, just think about it. I'm going to have a lot to think about today as we watch this one. Hey. Sore wa c'est la vie. Ja. Ikuzo. All right. Do me one big favor. I'm going to take a second to step outside, take a breather, to want to make sure no one's blowing up outside, and then we will be ready to wrap this one up.
As I try not to drop everything.
Okay, 5 seconds.
Hi.
Yes, it was my way.
Hi, Yonko Zaimas.
All right, cool. All right, we're good. I got one last one for us in the tank, my dudes. And then we got to go watch this Fortnite featuring Metallica. Okay. Well, it's been a blast. I think we all just got to think about... So yeah, go watch Ghost in the Shell. I think it's going to be a good one. I'll check that one out today, and then we'll figure out how we go from there. But hey, looking forward to that. And so, we've reached the end of our time together, but it's not the end of the day. Fear not. So, till then, I think we just got to think about what we saw today, you know? All these little motions, all these people trying to make some moves, some money moves, but, you know, ultimately just going a different direction with that, and sometimes that's no bueno. Let's just try to keep an eye on what we do. And, yeah, just, you know, just every day is a choice and figure out what you do with that one. But I think so far we'll be all right. I'm thinking about how Hollywood is really adapting all these video game stuff and all this electronics and like bringing that into the future. I think stuff like Ghost in the Shell started that movement in terms of like, whoa, what could we do? Like, what does our future look like? What is technology in a couple years? And then, you know, like, because the jack-in from Ghost in the Shell is what inspired The Matrix, the jack-in from The Matrix. So we have pop cultures that are influenced by history, and to see these things kind of paint a picture that obviously we're not there yet, but we're kind of there yet in a social standpoint, is very fascinating just to see like that hindsight in their mind. So that's a good one. That's a good one. I think it'll be crazy to see how, again, like if we start adapting all these futuristic films and like all these like technology focused ideas in Hollywood, well, I get curious to see where we'll end up. So we'll see if that's gonna be a good one, a funny one, or a scary one. But until then, no AI. Let's play some music without AI. No offense. So I think we got this. Hi. Last one. A nice drone. Ikuzo. Do it, kid. Yeah.
Peace.
All I am is a man. I want the world in my hands. I hate the beach, but I stand in California with the tools in my sand. Get the sleeves in my sweater, let's have an adventure. A head in the clouds, but my gravity centered. Touch my neck, and now touch yours. I'm you in those little high-waisted shorts. She knows what I think about, not what I think about. Do not. No, I'm talking about. No, no, it's too cold. Big bass, big frets. And now to let me hold both your hands in the holes of my sweater. If I may just take your breath away, I don't mind if there's much to say. Sometimes it's climbing inside your mind, so move to a place far away. The goosebumps start to rise in the minute that my left hand meets your waist. And then I wash your face, put a finger in my top left taste. Yeah, and these haunted door, everybody heart is for. Inside this place is warm.
outside it starts to pour. Coming down, one love, two mouths, one love, one house. No shirt, no blouse, just us, you find out. Nothing wrong with what I tell you about. No, 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 cause it's too cold for you here. And now, so let me hold both your hands in the holes of my sweater. Whoa, for you here. And now, so let me hold both your hands in the holes of my sweater. Whoa, whoa.
That's it.
Whoa, 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 whoa. My sweater, it's cold for you here. And now let me hold both your hands in the holes of my sweater. And it's too cold, and it's too cold, the holes of my sweater.
A beautiful Sunday. I hope we all learned something today. I hope we have a beautiful weekend. You know, the new week is going to start very, very soon. Work, school, business, adulting. But hey, keep your head strong. Have fun. Take some time to take care of yourself. And enjoy the little moments, you know? It's easy to miss them, but I hope they're there for you when you need them the most. But hey, it's been your boy, Assassin Alchemist. Ookami Stitch you. Ookami sa Stitch. That means Constellation of the Wolf. Assassin Alchemist. Wishing you a happy morning, cool afternoon, and better tomorrow. Until then, hasta la próxima.
I'll never be your monkey wrench. All this time to make amends. What do you do when all your enemies are friends? Now and then I'll try to bend. Under pressure, wind up snapping in the end. Ten, more than ten. Don't wanna be your monkey wrench. One more indecent accident, I'd rather leave than suffer this. I'll never be
have a good one.